Hello, welcome to the video. In this video, we're going to be looking at how to use Python and JavaScript to create a JavaScript-based visualization. This is going to be done using Python and Jinja2. This is not going to be an actual JavaScript tutorial, but I want to show how straightforward it is to use JavaScript in HTML and automate the creation of HTML pages using Python. All of the code shown in this video will be on my GitHub page, which is rggh. If you go there, you will see the template and the Python code. Now, what we want to focus on most is the Python code, which uses Jinja, as you can see here. And what we will be doing is we will be making an index2.html page based on a template, which we will also be creating. So the whole purpose of this video is to show what you can do once you've extracted some data from an API or web scraping and then you wish to visualize it. So a great way to visualize it is by using some boilerplate code, which you can get from ChartJS website, and then you can insert that into an HTML page. Once you've done that, you can work with it with Jinja. So as you can see here, Jinja is a fast, expressive, extensible templating engine. Special placeholders in the template allow writing code similar to Python syntax. Then the template is passed data to render to the final document. Okay, so to create a visualization using ChartJS, what we want to do is we want to go and get some data. We'll get some weather data using Python and requests, and we will get it using an API, which we've already registered for. I've got it for some weather information, and let's just quickly do that. So the site I've been looking at is called openweather.org, and as with any site that provides an API, they will provide you with an API call instruction example, and you can use that, and once you've registered you'll get an API key in your email, and then you can copy and paste their example code and then just substitute your API key in there. Now, if you're using an API, you may want to hide it from other people. You don't really want other people using it and using up your quota or abusing it. So if you want to hide it, this is a really good demonstration of using environment variables. It's on twillo.com, environment variables in Python. So I'm not going to cover that here because I've done it in previous videos, but what you really need to do is you need to create a .env file, and then you do import os, and you can do os.environment.get, and you can also install load.env if you want to, which is another way of extracting the environment variables. There we go, there's the example there from .env. Import load _.env. So yeah, without further ado, let's move on. Okay, so what I've done is I've used import requests, import os from .env, import load.env, my API key equals os.environ.get. The API key is inside the .env file, as per the article I just referred to. And then what I've done is I've just used URL equals and then an F string, and the F string contains the example code from the open weather website and API key in curly braces. So what's inside the curly braces is the same as the variable name that I've used here, because that variable is identical to os.environ.get API key. I've kept it the same. You could call it something different as long as you keep that. Actually, I can remove print API keys because I don't want to show that on the screen. So as long as your variable name here is the same as what you use inside the curly braces, then it's fine. Okay, so you're going to have your own site that you want to extract data from. So this is just an example of how to use an API with requests. So I'm just going to run this, run Python terminal, and there you can just see there I've got a response 200. So I had a response 400 when I was testing it, but when I read the information on the website, or 401, it said allow a couple of hours for your API key to be registered. So if you get any 400 errors, just check the documentation. It may actually just be you need to wait an hour or two while your API is set up for you. So next, let's have a look at how we're actually going to use our information that we've extracted. Next, this is the Python code which uses Jinja, so you must do Jinja2 import if you've not, or pip install if you've not already installed it. Copy all this basically, which just creates a template, or gets the template. Now the template is typically stored in a folder called templates. So as you can see here, on the right, we've got index2.html, and inside the templates folder, this one here, close that. So inside the templates folder, we create a file called index2.html, and then we use that template, and then we substitute these values into that template. And where do we put them? We put them here. Now, this is a lot of 70 odd lines here. What I've basically done is created a default HTML page. If you use VS Code, you just do exclamation mark, enter, and it will insert the bit that I've highlighted. I've then put in Bootstrap code, which you can get from the Bootstrap website. And then what I've actually done is I've just modified the H1 title, and then I've put in script. So from here, the script from line 30 down to line 64, all of that script came from chartjs.org. So you could use whichever example code you want from there. And that's all identical to what you would get from their site. Copy and paste it in, paste that whole script into the HTML template. And what I've actually done, the main point of this whole video really, is that you can then, even within JavaScript code, as long as it's inside your HTML document, you can then insert with a pair of curly braces your variable, your Python variable, into the HTML document, which is your template. When we go back to the Python code looks at the template, gets the template, and then it puts all of that into a new file called the same name, but in a folder called HTML. So that's the source and that's the output. So if you look at the output, where I had my variable, which was c_temps here. So this is the template HTML file. And then in the output, if we look at line 48, we've actually got our variables that we extracted using our API. I've cheated slightly here because I haven't gone and formatted a load of weather data, because that's beyond the scope of this video, and it's going to be unique to what you're actually doing. So let's just run it. So what you end up with in your directory is you have requests API, which goes off and gets your data. You have templates, which has got your index template. HTML, which is your output folder, and J1, which is my Jinja JavaScript Python code, which creates the output file, and it also inserts these variables. So if what I could have done would be to transplant all of this code into here, and then I could have read the dictionary that would have returned some JSON data for sure. I've not actually got the full data yet. I've not gone through and passed it, but let's do that actually. So if we go into request.api, and then we will just pass some data from it. Okay, so all I've done here is I've just imported from ppprint, import ppprint, that's just pretty print. And then all I've done is just done prettyprint response.json. And if we run that, I've got a load of weather data. So yeah, there we go. Clouds, humidity, pressure, sunrise, temperature, weather. And there we've got precipitation. Presumably that's time of day and then date. Oh, minutely. Okay. And we've got longitude and latitude. So yeah, I'm not going to go into how to parse JSON here. That's another video perhaps. So once you've got that data, you could then go and extract rain, temperature, whatever, within your code here, and then you put that into this variable here, and then you render it. And when you render it, the renderer gets the template, takes a template, and it inserts C temps into it, and then you will get an output file which will be identical to your template, except instead of having curly braces, it will actually have the real valid data. So next, let's open it in a browser and see what's actually produced. So if we go open in default browser, and we have ChartJS example using Jinja2 and Python. So hopefully what I've demonstrated here is that you can link requests, API, Python, Jinja to produce an HTML file containing some JavaScript, which then produces your visualization. It sounds complicated, but it's probably actually easier than doing matplotlib. And then once you've created something in matplotlib, what do you actually do with that? How do you display it to somebody? You then end up having to set up Python web server or Flask or whatever. Whereas here, I've just actually created a JavaScript or HTML page with some JavaScript in it. If we view the selection, if we view the source, as you can see here, it's actually quite minimalist and there's not really that much to it. And it's, there we go. We've created all that from some example code from ChartJS and some Jinja example code basically. But if you want to copy my code, feel free. I'll put the link in the description. It's all on GitHub. All I've done is actually insert 6 bits of data into the Jinja placeholder. You could put in many, many more. Obviously, because I'm only doing a graph with an X and Y, then I'm just changing the X's, because you put in the X's and then it creates the Y's. So there we go. That is how to use Jinja, JavaScript, Python, HTML, all put together. So it's a bit of an overview, really. If you want to really understand it, then probably the best thing to do is download my repo from GitHub, change some values, see what happens, and you can create many, many files. You could actually create you could do it with a loop as well, and you could create unlimited number of HTML files, one for each month, one for each year. The API, weather API, gives you current data, so I believe you have to pay to get enhanced bits of data, such as historical, if you want to go back in time and so on. But yeah, for the purposes of this video, or for the purposes of testing, get my repo from GitHub, sign up for an API, extract some data, request some data. So I'm focusing on using an API. If you want a web scrape, that's up to you, but obviously that's an extra process that you need to go through. And if an API is available, then you'd be mad not to use it. Why web scrape when an API is available? And that does seem to be the way the internet in general is going. And I think I've said enough about web scraping before. And if you want to illegally extract information from secure sites with logins, that's up to you. So everything I'm going to be doing from now on here is just extracting publicly available data, and free as well. I'm not going to be signing up to any APIs and getting expensive data when I don't need it. This is purely for educational purposes. So hopefully this has been intuitive, informative, and intuitive. If you've got any questions, drop me a line. And yeah, the best thing to do is just experiment, and you will learn. You will learn lots from experimentation. Don't forget to subscribe. Because of the algos, if you don't subscribe or comment, then we all may as well go home.